Google unveils its Chrome OS. We've got the latest prototype flexible displays, and it's robots galore in Tokyo. All that news and more on this week's World Tech Update. Welcome to World Tech Update. I'm Martin Williams, and this week we're coming to you from Tokyo. We start our news this week with Google's Chrome operating system. The company has released it to developers and given us a first look at what we can expect when it's launched sometime next year. The OS is targeted at netbooks, and it will be faster, simpler, and more secure than existing operating systems, according to Google. But it won't be for everyone. It'll run only web-hosted applications, so will be restricted to a narrower set of applications than current operating systems. Programs appear as application tabs in the top left-hand corner of this demo, and a menu allows access to other applications. The software isn't installed on the computer, but resides on Google servers, and that means that a good network connection will be vital if things are to run smoothly. It also means users aren't hassled with upgrades or patches. Look for it in about 12 months. Now on to Microsoft's Internet Explorer. A new version, version 9, is already under development, and we've got an update.
So the first is on standards. So there's been a lot of talk about standards. You know, we have a particular test, ACID 3, that we're not ahead of on, and we need to do a better job there. There are new and emerging standards that are still in committee, still in draft, still very early, like HTML5. And we want to be responsible about how we support that and also how we communicate what we're doing so that we don't generate a hype cycle for things that aren't there yet across the board for developers to take advantage of.
Here in Tokyo, the International Robot Exhibition, a biennial showcase of Japan's service and industrial robot industry, is taking place. And as usual, the show didn't disappoint. Among the attractions, a robot that builds Lego models. The RV2SQ from Mitsubishi isn't designed for this task, but it's a demonstration of how it can work with precision in close proximity to another robot. The RV2SQ is designed for small workshops and in small-size electric and electronic assembly operations where space is often limited. This robotic arm from Denso has a realistic human hand and can pick up pieces of cake without crushing them. The secret to its gentle touch are these small actuators that are built into the hand to allow for precision control of the grip. And this one from Toyota Industries can grab and place items on a tray, including hard products like cans and soft packages, like this onigiri rice ball. Robots from universities and research labs were also on display, like this prototype robotic wheelchair from the University of Tokyo. Sensor pads in the seat, seat back, and footrest allow the user to control movement of the chair by shifting their body weight. No joystick is required. And students from Tokyo's University of Science have developed a new version of their muscle suit, a wearable robotic suit that assists the muscles when carrying out strenuous tasks. The suit provides assistance to the back and makes it possible to lift 15 kilograms of weight with just your back muscles and those in the suit, something that will be difficult or dangerous for some people. Now, I wasn't the only one checking out robots this week. US President Barack Obama got a chance to check out a robot in Washington as he announced plans to strengthen the teaching of maths and sciences in the United States. He also announced plans for a White House science fair.
You know, if you win the NCAA championships, you come to the White House. Well, if you're a young person and you've produced the best experiment or design, the best hardware or software, you ought to be recognized for that achievement too. Scientists and engineers ought to stand side by side with athletes and entertainers as role models.
The Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation also said this week that it plans to invest $335 million to promote effective teaching and raise student achievement across the U.S. News in brief this week, and after 2 years of often bitter debate, the European Parliament approved a raft of new telecom laws. The laws are designed to give European citizens cheaper telecom services, more privacy, and a faster internet. With regard to file sharing, those suspected of illegally sharing copyrighted content over the internet will be assured the right of defence and the assumption of innocence rather than being cut off from the internet. It's no secret that Rupert Murdoch wants to start making money from news online, and now he may have found a partner. Reports earlier this week said News Corp is in the early stages of a possible deal that could see Microsoft pay to keep its websites from Google. The deal would give Microsoft's Bing search engine the exclusive rights to deliver News Corp content from sites such as The New York Times, The Sun, Sky News, and Fox News Channel. And the world's biggest machine, the Large Hadron Collider at CERN, the European Organization for Nuclear Research, is back in business. Operations were restarted over the weekend, aimed at full operation early next year. The LHC is hoping to reproduce conditions that existed just after the formation of the universe. Now to Taiwan, and on Thursday, researchers there unveiled the latest in their flexible display research. The screen, a 4.1-inch flexible OLED, is being developed for next-generation devices by Taiwan's Industrial Technology Research Institute. In terms of size, it beats a 2.5-inch flexible OLED that's been demonstrated by Sony, but is smaller than a 5.8-inch model from the labs of Japanese public broadcaster NHK. Taiwan's ITRI also showed a color e-reader touchscreen display with software that allows people to draw pictures and take notes, in addition to just reading. Back here in Japan, and a unique parking lot has won an environmental prize. The solar parking lot developed by Sanyo is currently on trial at government offices in Tokushima in western Japan and takes sunlight and turns it into electric power to charge up bicycles. A battery collects power from the solar panel and dispenses it to recharges. The combination of panels in a battery means it's possible to recharge bicycles without using any commercial power, even at night or on a rainy day. The lithium-ion battery system also features AC power outlets that can be used to power external equipment during an emergency or electrical power outage. And that's it for World Tech Update. Thank you for joining us this week. Nick is back in Boston next week. Don't forget to check us out on Facebook and follow us on Twitter. We're going to leave you with more shots of those wonderful robots at the International Robot Exhibition here in Tokyo. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next week.